Welcome, and we will get our meeting called to order. We are so excited to see so many familiar faces. We've got some wonderful musicians and athletes and professional educators and really some very strong academic students out here, and we are just thrilled you're joining us and we get to celebrate you this evening. And with that, we will begin with roll call. Mrs. Browning?
All members are present.
Wonderful. Next, if you could please stand and join us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We will begin with our special presentations, and for those of you who have not been to a meeting recently, we typically pause after we have all of our special presentations. So if there are individuals who would like to go home and do more homework or work on something special, you are welcome to leave. And with that, our first very special presentation is the 2018 Purdue Jazz Festival winners. And with that, we have Miss Deanna Pittman. There we are. Hello, Mrs. Pittman.
Good evening. It is my pleasure to introduce to you Mr. Chris Draven. He is our Performing Arts Department Chair at Carmel Middle, as well as our Band Director, and he is here to recognize our jazz band.
This is about 15 of our jazz band members. We weren't allowed to bring the whole 35-member group, but this is a selection of the Carmel Middle School Jazz Band. This year we've had a lot of great success. We meet twice a week and rehearse after school, and we're something unique at the school that we're really proud of. It's been a historic year because this is the first time in about 15 years that an Indiana band won at the Purdue Jazz Fest for the middle school room. And I give all the credit to these guys because they've really taken up the philosophy of working on the fundamentals, working on the basics, and then performing our craft to the next level. And I'm really excited. We're going to our second festival this year, this Saturday at the Ball State Jazz Festival. So thank you so much for asking us to be here. This is a big honor. Thank you. The students get a little certificate tonight, and we'd like to recognize Hikaru Akiba, Taylor Bowen, Joe Cronin, Sam Gagan, Sean Grove. Rex is not here tonight. Ava Laurier, Patrick Michael, Ian Peasley, Drew Perfetti, Gus Sanchez, Gavin Staley, and Conway Zhang.
Thank you.
Do you want to announce? Go ahead and announce.
Okay, now I would like to invite Mrs. McDaniel to come to the podium to talk about our rising stars.
Good evening. Thank you for having us. Gentlemen, could I ask you to come and stand by Dr. Dudley, please? So the Indiana Association of School Principals and Carmel High School are proud to present the Rising Stars of Indiana Class of 2019. Each Indiana high school was invited to recognize up to four students currently in the 11th grade based on their academic achievement. The Class of 2019 is surely promised success with these scholars. Please join us in congratulating these students on all they have already achieved, as well as offering support and encouragement as they continue their accomplishments and expand their knowledge, growth, and leadership skills well into the future. So I'd like to present, representing Carmel High School, Sefer Askari, Srinath Chala, Parker Ju, and Siddharth Samasi. I firmly believe one of these four gentlemen will most likely be our academic all-star for next year as well.
Now I would like to invite Mrs. Anna Kaiser to the podium for, we have a very special award for one of our students, our filmmaking students.
Hi, I'm Anna Kaiser, and I am the CHTV advisor, teacher, whatever you want to call me. And I met Justin 4 years ago when he was just a little freshman in my class. And since then, it's been a pleasure to have him and watch him grow over the past 4 years. From the beginning, it was clear that he was had just natural talent in cinematography and editing. And I knew that from your second project where you interviewed a hibachi chef, right? That your talent was only going to grow from there. So Justin is a one-of-a-kind student. He is willing to drop anything to help another student, be my eyes and ears when I'm not there, and just kind of be the heart and soul of CHTV. And so when he put on this, or when he did this project last year, it was a project that surprised me because he spent multiple days at a track meet, like went to multiple track meets to do this. And to get just some of my students just to go to one event is hard enough. And Justin just really spends his time to get the film that he needs. And so when Justin becomes famous, a famous filmmaker, which he will, I'm excited to be part of the beginning of your story, Justin. And I'm going to show you this amazing documentary that he made, a short documentary about Kara Didi, who is a pole vaulter at the school, and just really show off his talent that he has. I will miss him next year. He really is the heart of CHTV, and I hope he comes and visits me, even when he's famous. So I'm going to pull this up and show you what it's all about. This is like the prime example of what...
I like that it's kind of a mix of everything. You have the field events and the running from the sprint is important. So I think just putting it all together just makes it really fun. The first thing that's required is speed. On the runway, you have to start sprinting, and so you have to be able to get up a pretty good speed. And then going into the jump, you have to be strong enough to move yourself on the pole and then get yourself over the bar. The atmosphere of a meet, I think, is really fun. It's kind of relaxed because one vaulter can go at a time, so there's not too much of a rush, but you do have to be focused on what you're doing, what you need to do. I started vaulting my freshman year. I think I tried it just because it was something different. They don't offer it at the middle school, and it looked kind of fun, so I decided to try out. I didn't really know much about it before I showed up to the tryout. So since then, I learned the basic techniques, how it works actually, and then now I'm trying to focus on getting down those techniques, making sure that I can do it right, because that's what's going to get you to vault higher. For me, it's easy to balance the schedule, because especially during sport seasons with school, because I know that the work needs to get done. So I get home from practice, I know that I don't have a lot of time to do my homework, and so that gets me started right away so that I can get it all in. Having to balance schoolwork and track has definitely shown me the value of hard work, and that hard work is the only thing that's going to get me there. There's really no shortcut. My parents are very supportive. They both run track, and so they kind of know how it works, so they just support me in whatever event I choose and no matter how I do. So the coaches, they're really supportive, and they know even if you're under a lot of stress or overwhelmed, they'll keep you on track, direct you towards your goal, and then keep you working towards that. I feel most supported and motivated by my teammates. Even bad meets, good races, they're always going to be there, whether it's to provide encouragement or congratulate you. They make you feel like you're a part of the team, and then we do that for each other. So that is motivating because you don't want to let them down. I think I just know that I'm the only one who can make it work for me. Nothing else is going to be able to do it for me, so that motivates me because I know that I'm going to have to be the one to take it on myself to do that.
So as you can see, I think I'll probably be using this as an example for all my classes for many, many, many years to come. And so, Justin, I'm excited before this other YouTube video plays. To give you this award for being a Heartland Film Festival award winner. Congratulations, and I'm very proud of you.
And now I'd like to invite Mr. Jimmy Inske to come to the podium.
Thank you, Dr. Dudley and Mr. McMichael and members of the board. It's an honor and privilege once again to be before you to recognize an outstanding staff member at Carmel High School and Carmel Clay Schools. This is Colin Altavoet. Colin is our head boys cross country coach. He also serves as the distance coach for our track program as well. And Colin was recently recognized by the United States Track and Field Cross Country Coaches Association as their Coach of the Year. And since we appeared on the agenda, he's since been named the Indiana Association of Track and Cross Country Coaches Association Class 3A Boys Cross Country Coach of the Year as well. Colin is a teacher in our high school in our world language department, and his team was the 2017 state champions.
While Mr. Johnson gets things set up for his presentation on our Spotlight on Excellence, we will pause for a couple minutes if people would like to partake in other adventures instead of hanging out with us. That's okay. Ben, you have the floor.
All right. Well, first off, thank you very much for the opportunity to speak tonight. Greatly appreciate your time. Typically, I don't like to have the effect of standing up here and then having an entire room clear out, but so be it, I guess. Yes. So I just want to touch on a few things this evening. The first element that I'm going to touch on is on a end-of-the-semester basis, we offer up and contact all of the extended school enrichment parents and guardians. On our end of the semester survey, we have 9 different comments. This is a part of the survey. 9 different aspects of the survey that we gain their scale of opinion on. First off, touching on whether the program is providing a caring atmosphere, whether it's providing a safe environment, other areas, whether it's providing a positive experience, and then also such areas such as if matters have been handled in a professional manner. This is done on a scale of 1 to 5. 5 being they strongly agree with the comment, 1 being they strongly disagree. So with that scale in mind, I just wanted to touch on a few different areas. First off, we have obtained an overall average. So if you take a look at those 9 different comments, we've attained an overall average of 4+ for 17 consecutive surveys. So that's going back 8.5 school years. The other area on the providing a safe environment, we've been going on 19 consecutive surveys. So going back to the 2008 fall semester, that's been the area where we've scored the highest on, which without a safe program, we will achieve nothing. So that has meant a lot to us. And then within each of the 9 categories, we've obtained a score of 4+ for 16 consecutive surveys going back to the 2010 spring semester. So very happy and proud of those results, and we want to continue to build on the successes within our program. Next area that I want to touch on is the enrollment within our program. As you can see here, I just went back 3 school years. As you can see in our current school year, we have just over 2,300 students in the program. That's through February 20th. So the other 2 previous years are through an entire school year. So just through February 20th, we're actually up an increase of 1.8% from the 2016-17 school year. As also a frame of reference, while I don't have it included on here, we started up the program in the 2006-2007 school year. In that school year, we were just over 1,300 students. So we've jumped up approximately 1,000 students over time. So just more perspective. Next area that I want to touch on is just the commitment to staff development. We are very proud of the commitment that we make towards providing an exceptionally high quality program. That starts with our staff in the program. Just highlighting here, obviously, people are aware of CPR, AED, first aid certification. We also have the crisis prevention intervention certification. And then I also wanted to touch on the Darkness to Light Stewards of Children certification. For those of you who are not aware of this certification, that's a child sexual abuse training program. In that, the distinction is that at least 90% of staff, if you are to be certified in this, must go through training and must maintain training every 2 years. It's our commitment to our program that 100% of our staff members maintain certification. And then in addition to that, on a monthly basis at each one of the 11 elementary schools, there is an in-service of sorts, monthly trainings that, take place for all of our staff. And then the last slide that I want to touch on is, in my opinion, the most important aspect of our program. That's student voice and choice. So as an integral part of our program, we provide daily enrichment clubs, whether that's before school or after school. Typically, there are anywhere from 2 to 5 clubs that are taking place, depending upon the specific school. Of those different club offerings, at minimum, 50% are driven from students. So ideas that are directly generated from whether it's a kindergartner through a sixth grader. We obtain that information in many different ways, but the area that I want to touch on is through our interactive polling. We began utilizing this method last school year, where students are able, we direct them through a series of questions, options. They all have a device in their hand and are able to vote on that. And the part that they love is seeing the next slide that will come up from there are the results. So seeing what they voted on and then that immediate poll. So that's something that's been very well received and something that we're extremely proud of. And then the last area I just want to touch on, obviously they're selecting and providing us the various enrichment clubs that are in place. And then every day they get to choose from the various clubs that are in. And as is the case most time with younger students, they may make a selection and in 5 minutes into it realize they want to go to a different club. So it's all part of that student voice and choice that we're exceptionally proud of and a huge part of our program. So with that, once again, thank you very much for your time, and I'll open up if there are any questions.
Well, first, thank you so very much for coming and giving us an update. I know Katie and Pam in the past have served on the board and come back with such positive, phenomenal feedback, and we were very excited that you could join us. One thing they brought to us, which I wanted to mention tonight, that I know as a parent I found very appealing, is the drop-in, that you do not have to be registered for the entire week. If there's a particular day of the week, you have a drop-in program that really is so user-friendly. So thank you for providing that service.
Absolutely, thank you.
Are there other, Pam?
I just have two questions, please. One, I understand you have your teachers go through the darkness to light, and that's on sexual abuse. What do you do? What's your procedure when, if you locate a child that has been sexually abused, how do you report that to the school, or do you report that? I mean, I'm sure you do, but what's the procedure for doing that?
Yes. This has been something that we've worked very closely with both representatives within the school system as well as local authorities to have a protocol in place which works in large part with the appropriate individuals, whether that be a member of the police department or also individuals working within the school system. So we maintain that communication and also report that in a very expedited manner.
Okay.
So when that does come up, we one, take that extremely seriously, but then also make sure that we're following the proper reporting mechanisms.
Okay, thank you.
Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay.
And the other question is, can you give me some examples of your enrichment clubs?
Yeah. So actually, I was just over at, several schools today, but over at Forestdale, specifically, they had 4 different offerings. I'll highlight a couple of them. One of which was in the gymnasium. They had an activity going on by the name of Trash Ball. So that's, if you're familiar at all with the game of Ultimate Frisbee, it's a very interactive, team-oriented game. So that's an example of a physically active club. At the same time, there were, I didn't see any boys in it, but there was more of a beauty type club going on where they were actually getting their nails painted today. So that was a couple of the highlights, and I chose those specifically where we had really two ends of the spectrum going on. Now, I did ask some girls on the club if there were boys, if they could attend, and they looked at me a little bit odd and said, yes, I guess they could. Yes. Yes.
Can you give us a typical, like, what the schedule looks like when a child, so school gets over, and then mom and dad, guardian, pick them up? What are some of the things that they do in that time period?
Yes. So I'll just touch on if somebody's there for the duration of the program, what that would look like, and specifically after school. So at the conclusion of the school day, up until approximately 3:45, we will have, at most schools, divide them up into two different groups. Typically, that's a K through 2 and then a 3 through 5. There will be, at the start, approximately a half hour-ish in time, 30, 35 minutes. They will have a recess component. So they'll go outside for recess. Opposite that, the other group is having snack and just winding down and socialization, hanging out. At that time of 3:45 to 4:30, that is homework assistance. So we have that intentionally structured where parents are able to select whether they want, ranging from when my child steps into the program, the first thing they're doing is homework, they aren't going out for recess, they're doing homework, to the complete opposite end of the spectrum of they are not to work on their homework whatsoever in the program. If they do choose that, they're still doing something academic in nature. So in that 45-minute block is homework assistance. And then that 4:30 to 5:30 time is what I consider the extremely fun part of the program. Those are the enrichment clubs. And then that 5:30 to 6 time, there'll typically be a couple different options for students to be able to participate in. It's not in the club format, but different activities, and that's more of a wind-down period. We start to see those numbers drop off rather significantly from that 5:30 to 6 p.m. time. Yes.
Can you, I know that some students participate in like scholarship program. Can you explain a little bit about that?
Yes. So the financial assistance or scholarship program is based on federal poverty guidelines, based upon information that is provided, which is supported by, among other things, 1040 tax form, just to provide supporting documentation. It will range from anywhere from 100% financial assistance to sliding down to a 75%, 50%, or 25% assistance with the fees that do support the program. Yes.
Well, first of all, thank you for coming this evening. Second of all, I guess I don't know if my kids are alumni of the program, but as a parent whose kids participated, thank you again for that opportunity. And I'm really pleased to see the commitment to staff development and being personally knowledgeable about CPI training and have participated in Stewards of Children, and I'm assuming you go through Chaucy's Place. It is a great resource for our community, and in today's age, a scary thing that we need to be aware of and monitor, but I applaud the program on making that a priority. So thank you.
Thank you very much, and you are correct in your assumption it is through Chaucy's Place. Yes.
Yes, and thank you very much for sharing the ESE program with us tonight. And my daughter goes to ESE sometimes, and I'm very pleased with the program. And ESE is both before school and after school program. And I also want to point out that we have a transition here, actually, for ESE with the after school activities. So if your kids go to choir, go to the mass bowl, spell bowl, that the ESE actually can do the transition right before and after the activity. So that's really convenient for parents who are working. We'll worry about how they can handle kids go to different classes.
Yes, thank you for pointing that out, and that adds, I guess, in those times, our supervisors and staff look for that additional challenge. Well, programs going on, then you have a flood of maybe 20 new students at different times. But yeah, absolutely, it's a great service to be able to provide that to working parents.
I just want to tell you, I think I've told you this before, but I recently didn't work. I just started working full-time, and my children asked me daily, when can we go to ESE? When can we go to ESE? Your reputation precedes you. There are children begging all the time, and I'm like, soon, I promise. So I just want you to know that in the school, it is something that kids want to go to. So that is amazing, because that is your biggest critiquers. They'll tell the truth if it's not fun, if they're not enjoying it. So congratulations on that.
Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Ben. And if there's anything we can do as a school system to help support the program as well, please be sure to let Amy and Roger know as well.
Absolutely.
So, thank you again. Thank you for joining us. And seeing that we do not have anybody wishing to participate in public participation, we'll move straight into consent. May I get a motion on the table to approve consent?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Next, we have action. And our first action item is the adoption of Policy 3500. And to that, we will turn to the Policy Committee. Pam, yes.
Yes, this is a wellness. This is being brought to you for second reading. We brought this to you February 12th for first reading. This is a change in a policy to just replicate what the school system is currently doing, and we wanted to make sure that we duplicated it in policy. So we have the one change being they most recently completed their performance evaluation in an Indiana public school, not just Carmel Clay Schools.
Thank you, Pam. May I get a motion on the table to approve changes to Policy 3500, Teacher Appreciation Grant?
So move.
Second?
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Thank you. Next, we run into a variety of policies for discussion. First discussion reading is Policy 8510, Wellness. Pam.
Okay. We have a policy in place, and if you look at your page, you'll see that the current policy is at the bottom of the page, and lines are completely going through the whole thing because we've completely changed the policy. And we have added the committee that needs to be evaluating the wellness program on a yearly basis, and they need to be bringing that to the board, and which will be the advisory council. And this was reviewed by food services. In addition, the addition of the coordinated school health advisory council and other changes were needed to comply with state and federal regulations. So we are bringing this policy back to you for approval. Seems like sometimes we bring things constantly because there's constant changes and things, and this is one of those policies that continues to be updated.
Open up the floor to discussion. I'll just point out, I happened to be leaving Carmel High School and bumped into Jennifer McFarland.
Oh.
And she was very excited about this policy.
Good.
Most of what is in this policy, actually, which seems very unusual for us with policy, comes from the USDA. And there's just an entire list of requirements. It's not stated as statute, it's stated as just their requirement. So that's what she's used and to help develop this particular policy. And it aligns with the IDOE, and council has checked it out. So thank you for doing this for us. Well then, with that, we'll move on to our second policy for discussion this evening, and that's the first reading of 4350, Student Suicide Awareness and Prevention.
Yes, HEA 1430, Public Law 254 in 2017, required all school corporations to adopt a policy intended to increase student suicide awareness and prevention. The statute sets forth specific items that must be addressed in the policy. And the Indiana Department of Education, along with our general counsel, has recommended the changes below. And so if you look very carefully at the very bottom, you will also see our current policy has been struck through because that one is totally gone, and we have a total new policy again.
Thank you, Pam. Questions? Okay, and next we have policy 4630.01, restraint and seclusion.
Yes, I know we've brought this policy before, but it needs to come back because, again, this is one of those that constantly changes. And so we have a change requiring SROs to report the use of seclusion and restraint to the administration, and the school administration is to report it to the IDOE. So this has been changed in 2017, so this is presenting the change to that law.
Discussion? Question?
So I guess I just want to clarify. So the only changes is what's indicated in here dealing with SRO reporting, and I'm assuming that our experts in restraint and seclusion had approved this. You know, the rest of the policy in the past, and it was just confusing to me what's a restraint and what's not a restraint, knowing just enough to probably be dangerous about this topic. And I know we use CPI mm-hmm. as guidance, so I guess I'm just looking for confirmation that the rest of the policy has been approved by those that know much more than I.
Yes. Oh, go ahead.
Well, no, I was just going to say Amy is going to jump in.
Well, when we first were required to develop a policy, our team that works on restraint and seclusion, they developed that policy, and then we ran it past our general counsel as well. We took recommendations from DOE. And then the only change was that in the reporting was that when an SRO is involved, we have to report that to DOE. So that's what this policy is changing. But this was, again, reviewed by our team that works on that, and yes, it was all approved.
Any other questions for the policy committee? Then Pam and Lynn, we will bring these back then in 2 weeks for a
March 26th.
Thank you. March 26th. That
yes.
sounds perfect.
Thank you.
And next on the agenda, we have our monthly financial update. Roger.
Thank you. Of course, this is the first month of our budget year. So not a lot to report, but I would remind the board and the public that our revenue for our budget is a combination of two fiscal years, because we receive revenue. The formula is from July 1st to June 30th, but our budget is built on a calendar year. On the other hand, our local revenue from our local referendum is primarily from property tax, so that revenue is a calendar year. So we have a combination of revenue coming in on a calendar year, and it changes accordingly, but we also have revenue coming in, the basic grant, the majority actually of the revenue is coming in on a fiscal year, so we're putting kind of two halves together. Then on the expenditures, that is a calendar year, which it's always been, but because a large number of our staff are teachers, and their contracts are on fiscal year. So so the reporting is on a calendar year, but the calculations are a combination of calendar year in some expenditures and some revenue. And likewise, the expenditures, some of them are calendar year and some are a combination of two fiscal years. And we are our balances and so forth beginning this calendar year budget are pretty much right on target with what we had projected.
Thank you, Roger. I know the board had a number of different questions that came through. Did anybody have any questions that they needed further clarification?
No, I got it clarified before the meeting started.
There you go.
Okay. Seeing that there are no additional questions at this time, we appreciate you bringing this before the board.
Thank you.
And we look forward to further updates.
Okay.
And you might get additional questions as we review a little longer.
That's okay.
Okay, and to that, we'll turn to our superintendent's report, and I know with all the fantastic things that have been happening, both Amy and Roger have a lot to share.
We do. We have lots of great things to share. First, we want to congratulate the Carmel High School boys swimming and diving team, who won their fourth consecutive IHSS, IHSS CCSAA State Championship. Not only did they win, but they won 9 out of the 11 events at the state meet, and they set a state record for the most points scored in an IHSAA State Championship meet. And secondly, then, I'd like to give a positive shout-out to the Carmel Dance Marathon. It was held over the weekend. It's the largest dance marathon in the state and a wonderful event in which more than 1,000 Carmel High School students have fun raising money for Riley Hospital. And this year, they raised over $453,000.
So in addition to that, you may have noticed on the news recently and also on our social media, but last week we had a group of Carmel High School students and their teacher, Sarah Wolf, placed more than 5,100 positive notes on every student's locker, and it was part of the Random Acts of Kindness Challenge, and many students still have those notes on their lockers as the act of kindness and showcases how wonderful our students and our school community are. And it really did touch the hearts of so many of our students, and it was very meaningful to them. Also, last Thursday evening, Roger and I were very excited to host Math Bowl. And I have to say that Math Bowl went off without a hitch, unlike Spell Bowl. We didn't have any issues with reading the problems.
We're experienced now.
Yes. We're pros now. And we would like to congratulate West Clay Elementary for being named the district winner in the competition. And also, they are also the state winner. And so we'll have them here at a later date to congratulate them. And on another note as well, today started the part one of the very last time that we will do I-STEP in grades 3 through 8 and also in 10th grade. Right. We'll have part one, and then in part two we'll have at the end of April and the beginning of May, and next year it will morph into I-Learn. And we will only have one session of iLearn, so that'll be a good thing as well. So make sure, you know, students are well-rested, they get a good breakfast, you know, they come prepared to school to do their very best on I-STEP. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Question on iLearn, is that going to be a fall or spring?
It will be a spring. And okay. We don't have the exact dates, but it should be in the very end of the spring. So it should be similar to the second session of I-STEP,
okay.
Towards the beginning of May, probably.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Kirshner, you have a few.
I do have a few. And that I-Learn is a perfect segue to the legislative update, being that that's where it comes from. This session, as you all know, is a short session, non-budget year. The session will end on March 14th, so they are winding down. The bills that are currently still alive are in committees from the opposite house. So if they get out of committee and pass both houses, then they can go to conference committee. I shared with the board members today the ISBA legislative update for the bills that they're watching. And then on February, must have been the 8th, I did participate in the ISBA webinar where they had a senator and a representative speak on their legislative activities and what ISBA was doing. So, again, this has been kind of a slow year, at least for our efforts, but what we're doing is maintaining our relationships with our legislators. And kind of just monitoring what's going on. There will obviously be some things that will pass and will affect us, but nothing that I guess has us marching down to complain about.
Okay.
So that is that report.
Okay. Does anybody have any questions with regards to the legislative report? Any? Pam?
Nope.
Okay. I know we received an email from a concerned parent, and board members had questions as well. I know there is a Senate bill about weapons.
33.
Senate Bill 33. We currently do not house any religious services in our school buildings. Is that correct, Roger?
I believe that's correct, that we do not at the moment. We have over the years, and certainly that's permissible, and it's a part of our facility use policy that that it's not specific to a church, but we do not exclude church start like a startup church. A church cannot use our schools on a permanent basis. So typically, over the years, it has been a church, an established church that perhaps is growing, and so they're needing additional space until they build. And so, if they show evidence that they are in not just thinking about building, but they're actually in some process, then that's permitted for a certain period of time, and then a startup church. So we have had churches fairly routinely, really, but at the moment, I don't believe we have any. But this law would, yeah.
Go ahead. I opened it up.
Would be an issue.
Yes, you did. If by chance this bill passed today, which I have not heard yet, mm-hmm. and it makes it legal to have guns in a church, even though the church is has a school, or if it's on school property, mm-hmm. that would mean that our policy, where people are not allowed to carry guns, would be in conflict with the law.
Correct.
So how would we remedy? I mean, but the law also states that if the school can't, the schools can make a policy which does not allow guns on the property. So I don't know how all of that would be worked out.
Well, I'm not 100% sure, because with any new legislation, it sometimes takes a while to get all the interpretations. But I would suspect that the board and the administration would be inclined, if we have a choice, that we would subject the use of the facility or the rental of the facility, as we do now with any group, that it's subject to a number of things, insurance and the routine kinds of things, but could also be subject to not permitting firearms, if that's a choice.
I certainly hope so. Okay, thank you.
But again, I mean, these activities are non-school hours.
They are.
That if it were to pass, it's not during the day when students are there. It would be either in the evening or on the weekends.
I'm hesitating because they're typically not going to be during, they're not going to be during the school day, the regular school day. But as the board knows, we have any number of activities, some buildings more than others. We have lots of students and lots of people in general at a school at any given time, particularly our secondary schools. So if that were the case, it wouldn't, oftentimes it's not just the church or just the facility rental that is using the space.
Mm-hmm. And all the more reason for Pam's concern that
exactly.
we need to be watching this and develop our own policies mm-hmm. as much as we can.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments? Okay, jumping into the superintendent search. Mike, you.
Thank you again. Here is the update on the superintendent search. Our application officially opened or went live online at the ISBA website a week ago. So that would be February 19th. The application period or the open time to apply will expire on April 6th, which is the Friday of our spring break, the last Friday of our spring break, after which the process of reviewing those applications will get underway. Also, I wanted to update the board that Layla and I had the opportunity last Wednesday and the Wednesday before to meet with both elementary and secondary administration. Part of that process was to update them on the superintendent search, and I think the other part, and I'll let Mrs. Benenberg jump in, was to kind of just open up our routes of communication with them and to kind of put it back in their laps is not the right word, but to ask them for ideas and suggestions as to how we can do a better job hearing their concerns while staying out of their way. And so I know that's something that's coming up, and I know that it was well received for both points of us being there. We did make clear that we were there as representatives on behalf of the board, because if all of us were there, it would be a public meeting, and that all of us are here for their concerns. Moving along with superintendent search, I also spoke with Pete O'Hara, who is the president of the Carmel Teachers Association, to just talk about how they could be involved in the superintendent search, which segues to the next idea, which I know all the board members are aware of, but there was a thought exchange that went to our administrators and to CTA leadership to gather feedback from them on what they thought was important qualities and characteristics of our next superintendent. So that was kind of the first opening to CTA. We will have a open dialogue with them and, as appropriate, involve them in the process. I also asked him to kind of brainstorm with his group to see what, after they went through the thought exchange, if they thought there were other things that they could provide. And I want to give a shout out to Layla for getting that organized. I know we've got a lot of responses already, and that's going to close, correct me, the end of this week?
28th.
The 28th. Mm-hmm. And so from that, we will segue into the broader community input. We're still working on what that process will look like, but it will be a way for those in the community to give input into the search process. And at this point, I think that is all I have. I'm happy to answer questions from the board.
Mike, I think you did a great job summarizing. So we do not have any questions apparently at this time, so that's fantastic. And if we do, we certainly will be emailing those. Once a thought exchange closes, I'll just quick summary. Once that closes on the 28th, everything is confidential. I will be compiling all that data and sharing it directly with our board. And we will have some really solid, I know you've been able to look through the feedback, which it's a very powerful feedback. So I'm very excited to see the direction that we get to take this with our developing our profile and how this helps support our interview process.
Yeah.
So a lot of good stuff out there. Big announcement we have is there's only two meetings until spring break. Woohoo! So excited.
March.
And the weather is going to be absolutely lovely this week. So good stuff. Roger and Amy, do you have anything else you'd like to contribute to the meeting this evening?
No.
No? Board? Mm-hmm. Yes, Katie.
I just want to say a general, one of the things that is put into our consent is approval of gifts or donations that are given by companies, community members, and parents. I just want to say a blanket, like, we appreciate that. We are so thankful to the people who give to Carmel Clay Schools, and we don't always say that, but I just kind of wanted to do a big thank you to the people and the PTOs and the organizations that give their money, and even more so when they give their time to our school. So thank you very much.
So, you know, maybe you want to quickly touch on that. I know not everybody and everything is included on that particular consent item. So how do we differentiate who jumps on and who is on that list?
Actually, anybody or any organization that proposes to give something to the school district, by statute, those gifts are supposed to be accepted. The underlying reason for that is that sometimes there are gifts that become liabilities rather than assets, and or there have been over the years. And I don't mean just Carmel schools, but just school districts in general. And so to kind of avoid that, the intent of the statute is that the board will be required to accept the gift. Now, most of the time, the gifts are very well received and very much appreciated. And I was noticing on this particular month, the gifts are well over $20,000. We had one PTO that donated $15,000 just at one school. Another local company donated 24 of the Vera desks. That's the units that provide for a stand-up desk. And those things are several hundred dollars a piece, and they donated 18 of them to Carmel High School. And so one person donated a car for for the technology department at Carmel High School. So money was donated for this our C4 conference, all of which is very appreciated. Carmel schools are very well supported by our PTOs, and their contribution and support of their local school is just a very high value to the district.
Thank you. Just want to mention that the Taste of Carmel is coming up this week on Thursday, and that is Orchard Park's money making, so they can give it back to the school.
And if you're not going to that and you would like to go to the high school, it's 6:30 on March 1st. Amy?
It's mental health awareness evening, and they will have a panel of different people in the community that offer mental health services, and parents can go and learn more about that and then also ask questions. And that's on March 1st as well at the high school.
And you could go to that and then go to the Taste.
Oh.
So any other comments?
Following along the contributions and the PTOs and the fundraisers, I had the privilege of attending the Woodbrook fundraiser that was Saturday night, called the Main Event, which was an adults-only evening, which was a lot of fun, and it's Maine, like a lion's mane. So now I put together the mascot and the mane, and they had a nice auction and a nice turnout, and again, their staff was there, and just the amount of work that that PTO, and I know all the PTOs do for the schools, is just unbelievable. So as a board and as a community, we should be very thankful for that. And I know we've kind of talked about what our roles are in liaisoning to the schools. This may be an opportunity to look at about having us support their events.
Thank you. I will we're just going to make this meeting go on to like 9 o'clock. So hopefully my last comment. When Mike and I did speak with the leadership with the middle schools, the high school, as well as the elementary and the ESC leadership, one of the components of that conversation was, what does our relationship look like? Communication is so important to us, and we value each and every employee. And over the years, we have, we used to have a very, very formal liaison program, which was very scripted, and it wasn't as user-friendly for the principal and the teachers as well as the board. And we have shifted, but we haven't shifted in any direction that really defines how we can be involved and have a very positive, mutually beneficial relationship. So we left them with what would work best with the culture and environment in your school, and the principals are talking amongst their teachers, their leadership at school, and they're providing ideas to Amy, who's going to feed that to us. And then once we have that information, we can better put together a more solid communication plan, as well as a way for us to be more involved, appreciating, and they appreciate that we are not there to micromanage. We are just there to to be a welcome wagon and smile and be excited about what they're able to do and what they want to do with, and for our students. So we're there to celebrate them, and I think they better understand that's our role. And so they're providing us feedback on what would work best with their school environment, and then we can just move on from there.
Oh, good.
So, yeah, very excited about that. And I think that's it.
Is it?
Meeting adjourned.
Okay.